Welcome to worship. On a day when you could be doing just about anything, you have chosen to be here with us, and we are grateful. Bondhead United Church lives in the traditional territory of the Wendat, Haudenosaunee, and Chippewa people on Treaty 18 land. And I acknowledge the history of the relationship between the First Peoples and newcomers to this land is complicated. And I commit to working toward right relationships among all people who call this land home. Please join with me in our call to worship. Jesus began his ministry to the world, led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Let us be led by the Spirit into uncomfortable places. As we seek to follow Jesus, we are tempted by the world to believe what is not true and would pull us away from the source of strength. Let us be led by the Spirit into comforting places. As we follow the path of faithfulness and hope, let us be led by the Spirit into rejoicing. Come, let us worship together. Let's pray together. God, you have not said we will never be tempted or troubled or distressed. You have never said we shall not overcome temptation or trouble or distress. You have faithfully traveled with us, as near as breathing, through the wildernesses of our lives, urging us to call on you for help and to trust in your presence. we respond with gratitude to your grace, thankful for the many ways you show up in our lives. Continue to guide us, we pray, in the name of the one who went into the wilderness, yet was never alone. Amen. Our scripture reading today comes from Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 to 11. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." And Jesus answered, "It is written, 'Man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God.'" Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their arms, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone.'" And Jesus answered him, "It is also written, 'Do not put the Lord your God to the test.'" Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." And Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, 'Worship the Lord your God and serve him only.'" And then the devil left him, and angels came and attended to him. This is our sacred story. Thanks be to God. This is a great story. When I did my first read-through of this scripture passage, something leapt from way back in my memory banks. So I want to share it with you. Watch this.
I said, "What, another dress? So this is ridiculous. Three dresses in a week, another dress?" And she tells him, "I didn't want to buy this dress. The devil made me buy this dress." She said, "I was going down the street. I was minding my own business, singing to myself." I said, "What you say, honey?" And the devil stopped following me, telling me how good I look.
Rev said, "I'm not going for that." He said, "Because every time you do something wrong, you blame it on the devil." So you blamed it on the devil when you ran the car into the side of the church. She tells him,
"It was the devil. You wasn't there. How do you know?" Said he grabbed that steering wheel out of my hand.
Griff said, "Well, why didn't you step on the brake?" She tells him,
"Because when he grabbed the steering wheel, I tried to kick him. I can't kick him and step on the brake at the same time." Said we had a big fight. "That's why I was in the back seat when y'all got the call."
Rev said, well, how'd the devil get you to buy the dress?
She said, "I was going down the street and I was singing, 'What you say, honey?' Every day. And I heard the devil coming up behind me with tiptoeing. And I said to myself, 'I'm not going to look back because I know it's the devil.'" And then he sneaked up and leaned over my shoulder and said,
"Say, mama, look at that dress in the window there. Said it's on sale, so that's your size too. Got a lot of flowers. You know you'd like a lot of flowers. So why don't you treat yourself to that dress?"
I said, "Cut that out, devil. I ain't buying no dresses. You better leave me alone, honey.
Devil said, well, why don't you try it on? You can try it on. Rev will never know about you trying it on. It's free. They're not going to charge you nothing to try it on. You owe yourself a try on.
I said, I'm not even trying it on, devil. I'm not even going to go in there and look at it. That's when the devil shoved me in the door. He said, the devil shoved me in the door. I said, cut that out, devil. And he pushed me over to where the dress was. And he threatened me. And made me try it on. Then he pulled a gun. And made me sign your name to a check.
Flip Wilson was one of 10 children. Born in Jersey City, New Jersey, during the Great Depression. His father was a handyman who was often out of work. And when he was 7, his mother abandoned the family, and most of the children were placed in foster care. When he was 16, Flip lied about his age and entered the Air Force. There he got the nickname Flip because he was so funny he made people flip out. By 1970, he was the first Black American to host a primetime television show and had a full career as a comedian and an actor. His phrase, "The devil made me do it," became a catchphrase nationwide. And it could be that Flip Wilson's notion of the devil manipulating people into doing something they ought not be doing came from this passage in Matthew that I just read. The thing is, the devil is not the central figure in this story. The central figure in this story is not even Jesus. The central figure in this story is the mission. Jesus is contemplating a mission, a ministry that will ask of him his very life, and yet he commits to it, knowing that his life is worth it. What is this mission that takes center stage in this story? Well, we can find it in the temptations. The first temptation is the story in this story is about food. Jesus is hungry, and the devil says, "Why don't you just turn these rocks into bread?" And Jesus replies, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." You can feed a person, but unless that person has a reason to live, that bread is just gravel in their mouth. The mission is not just to feed the hungry, but to point them toward goodness in the world, to give them hope. The second temptation is the story in this story is about living dangerously. The devil says, climb up to the highest tower in the temple and jump off. God's angels will catch you. And Jesus replies, it is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. A social safety net is a fine thing to have, but it should not replace good public policy. A social safety net to catch people when they fall is a good thing to have, but it should not replace good public policy. Governments should not rely solely on the goodness of others to meet the needs of the vulnerable. Good public policy is to do more than catch people as they fall, but to give them no reason to jump. Like the Simcoe County Alliance to End Homelessness, who is trying to find long-term solutions. People who are adequately housed have a far greater likelihood of not living dangerously or self-destructively. Good public policy looks long-term at solutions that are holistic and broad, more than just feeding the hungry, but giving them hope and a reason to live. The third temptation is about power. The devil says, I'll give you everything you see if you just fall down and worship me. And Jesus replies, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Power is nothing more than a tool that can be used to build a better world. a world that is good. We hear so much in the news about people wanting to be in power, that the struggle for power is behind everything. But power is just a tool. It is a fleeting thing. It goes through your fingers like sand. It cannot be retained forever. But it is a powerful tool to use in creating a better world if it's used appropriately. Power is something that is often misunderstood, and anyone in a leadership role learns pretty quickly what the meaning of power is.
I believe that we must change the ideology of being powerful, because we think that a person with guns, with money, is powerful. But we have developed this idea in our mind. And if we change it, and I think we must change it, a country with more literate and educated people, a country with more skillful people, a country which has given equal rights to its citizens, should be considered the superpower, not the country with atomic bombs and millions of soldiers. This is what I believe.
This is something that Jesus contemplated as part of his mission. And what is that mission? What do these temptations tell us about that mission? Well, it's not only feeding the hungry, but giving them hope. Not only providing a social safety net, but addressing the underlying causes of poverty, stigma, and judgment and cruelty. It's opening the eyes of those who are blind to how people get pigeonholed and forgotten. And it's not expecting God to fix everything. And it's about using power appropriately in the service of a greater good. This is the mission that Jesus signed on for, the one he gave his life to. And this is the central character in this story. It is the central character in our story. This week, I had a lot of meetings, and there was a common thread that ran through all of them. How do we do mission in the 21st century? And Jim Keenan said something in one of our meetings that struck us. Jesus' ministry operated inside and outside of the temple. If we want a clear picture of our mission, we should consider, when we're thinking about mission, God's work in the world. What do you see inside and outside the church? So I think it's important to consider not only the work that we do collectively as a congregation, but to include in that work the work that you do outside of the congregation. What is God's work that you're doing outside of the work of the congregation? When we put those two together, it helps us to understand mission. Are we collectively in line with the mission that Jesus laid out for himself? So take a minute, go grab a pen and a piece of paper. You can push pause and go grab a pen and a piece of paper and write down all the things that you do to make life worth living for someone else. List the charities that you support, the volunteer work that you do. Think about the times that you reach out, that you call a friend who is down, offer to drive someone who needs a ride, pick up groceries for a neighbor, drop a loonie in the cup of a stranger. Think about how you vote, when you pay your taxes, when you wrote a letter to your local councillor or member of parliament. Think about how you have used your position of power in the workplace or an organization to make life better for someone. And write them all down, and then compare them to Jesus' ministry to feed people and to give them hope, to provide a social safety net and address the underlying causes of poverty, to use power appropriately in the service of a greater good. Are you on track with Jesus? Is there something you feel called to do or to let go? Spend some time in prayer. while we listen to this choir sing Psalm 91.
Deep spirituality.
Profound.
Deep spirituality.
Deep spirituality.
Bold
discipleship.
Une vie de disciples
bold
dynamique.
Discipleship.
Bold discipleship.
Bold discipleship.
Une quête audacieuse de justice.
Daring justice.
Daring justice.
Daring justice.
Daring justice.
These are words that express the intent of all the major statements made by the United Church of Canada over the last number of years.
We live in a world that is largely individualistic. And when I think of discipleship, I think of commitment to God, commitment to a life following Christ, but also commitment to one another.
It's really about how we're working to live and do our ministry together as this United Church of Canada.
We have to dare to love. We have to dare to dream of a world in which love reigns. And I think this is the ultimate test for modern Christians.
Whether it's men in the world, justice-seeking, justice-living church, towards 2025, it's found in our Song of Faith and in the New Creed.
Ceux-ci sont les piliers de qu'est-ce que ça veut dire d'être l'Église de l'avenir. C'est sur cette base que nous pourrions être capables de répondre à l'appel de Dieu.
These words.
Deep spirituality.
Bold discipleship.
Daring justice.
Is an expression of who we are as the United Church of Canada.
This is our call. Let's make it our commitment.
We pray to the living Christ. 40 days alone, a wilderness of thoughts, tempting and inviting thoughts, which could so easily have distracted you from your task, your mission, your vision. And yet you emerged, stronger and more attuned to all that had to be done, despite a time constraint that to our eyes would have seemed hopeless. We too live in stressful times. Demands are made of our time that leave so little for the important things in life. We are easily distracted in the wilderness of our lives by every call to go this way or that, to turn stone into bread, to leap from mountains, to do all that would keep us from the truth. We listen to the voices of this world and ignore the one who endured all this and so much more, and emerged triumphant that we might not have to suffer so. Holy God, we thank you for Jesus, the living Christ, who shows us by his example how to navigate the world. In these quiet moments, hear our prayers about the bumps and turns in our journey, the times we became distracted, the people we love and worry about, the voices of this world that we'd like to ignore. We offer these prayers in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn is written by composer David Kai. He's a Canadian composer. David grew up in Toronto attending the Centennial Japanese United Church. He's a graduate of the University of Toronto Humber College Music Program, where he specialized in arranging and composing. And he also graduated from the Center of Christian Studies, commissioned as a diaconal minister. David served in pastoral charges in Birtle, Manitoba, Orleans, and Ajax, Ontario. This song that he has written is called Fear Not, For I Am With You.
Strengthen, I will help you, uphold you, cast
We have sung, we have prayed, we have worshiped together. Now we go back out into the world. We go out as people who are strengthened by our connections, ready to love and serve, ready to carry God's love to the world. As you journey through the ups and downs of the coming week, remember that God, who has invited us into relationship, is always with us. Go with God as the people of God. So be it. Amen. Have a great week, everybody.